be upon him, is praying to Almighty God that when the life was given to the dead, it was given by Almighty God. So all the miracles that were done, they were done by Almighty God, and Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, was a messenger. So all the miracles that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, did, Moses, peace be upon him, did, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, did, these miracles are signs of Almighty God given so that his followers will understand he is a messenger of God. And this is mentioned in the Bible, in the book of Acts, chapter number 2, verse number 22. Listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God amongst you by wonders and miracles and signs which God did by him, and you witnessed to it. A man. It's mentioned in the book of Acts, chapter number 2, verse number 22. Ye men of Israel, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God amongst you by miracles and wonders and signs which God did by him, and you have witnessed to it. That means all these miracles God did just to prove that he was a messenger of God. That doesn't make that person God. That doesn't make that person superior. So all the miracles that were done by messengers were done by Almighty God as a sign to show that he is a messenger of God. Hope that answers the question, brother.
Meaning the person died twice.
That person died twice. Miracle means exception to the rule.
And please, Jesus asked God for something in the Bible which God didn't also do.
Sorry?
The night before Jesus was crucified in the Bible, Jesus went into the garden and prayed so that God could have changed things. You could see, the Bible says that he sweat. Even on the cross, you could see that it wasn't a willing thing. But Jesus, God didn't do that for Jesus at that time. So I don't see it like Jesus would say, oh, come out of death. Then God did it there. But Jesus went into the garden, prayed, God didn't do. Which is not a consistent thing in Jesus' life, because not all the things in his life he was able to do.
What, in his life?
He asked God in the garden the day before he was crucified.
Yes,
he
prayed, I know that.
For things to change, but nothing happened. He fulfilled the thing. What God said.
First, I'll answer your first question, then I'll come to your second. Your first question is, did the man die twice? Yes. The miracles are things which are outside the natural thing. When Moses, peace be upon him, parted the sea, for the sea to part is not natural. It becomes a miracle. Correct? So similarly, when Jesus gave life to the dead, a human being dies only once. When Jesus gave life to the dead, he comes back to life. Miracle done by Almighty God. For example, a human being is born from a father and mother, right?
Yes, sir.
But Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was born miraculously without male intervention. It's a miracle from God. That does not make Jesus God. Some Christians say, no. See, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, had no father, so he's God. So the reply to that is given in Surah Imran, chapter 3, verse number 59. Inna masala Isa in the laika masala Adam. Khalaqa min turab, summa qala lahu kun fayakun. The similitude of Jesus in front of Allah is like Adam, peace be upon him. He was created from dust and said, be, and it was. If you say that Jesus is God because he had no father, then Adam, peace be upon him, is a greater God. He had no mother and no father.
Please, excuse me, I'm not a Christian.
I've not answered your question. Yeah. If you ask a question, you should wait for the reply. When you ask a question, you wait for the reply. After I finish the reply, then you can talk. Correct? You have to follow rules and regulation.
Okay, sorry.
So when Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, with the will of God, gave life to the dead, it was a miracle. That person will die twice. Coming to Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him. You rightly said in the Bible, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, before he was put on the cross, he sweats and he prays to God. Let this cup pass away from me, correct? He prays. And what happens? God saves him. God saves him. When he can give life to the dead, to a common man, and when he cries to God, can't God save him? God saves him. That's the reason he doesn't die on the cross. According to the Bible, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, did not die on the cross. And I will prove it to you. If you read the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 12, verse number 38, people come and ask Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, that please show us signs and miracles. So Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says,
the son of Jonah.
Brother, will you listen to me? Do you understand English?
Understand.
You're asking a question, I'm giving the reply, again you're coming in between.
Please, please. I was just trying to say, I've looked at your, was Christ really crucified? And I know it.
But if you knew, you wouldn't have asked this question.
No, but you didn't hear my
brother,
question.
Brother, let me finish the answer. If you have heard my question, you would have become a Muslim by now. If you would have heard all my lectures, by now you have been giving the Shahada.
I respect your speeches a lot. I respect your lectures. I respect your lectures and I like it.
Very good. I'll come to it later on. My respects will come to it later on. First, I'll give the reply. If Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, cried to Almighty God one day before he was put on the cross, what did God do? God saved him. The Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 12, verse number 38 to 40. When people say, show us a sign, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says, ye evil and adulterous generation, seeketh thee after a sign. No sign shall be given to you but the sign of Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the fish, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Now, every Christian knows what is the sign of Jonah. You go to Book of Jonah, 1.5 sides. You know that Almighty God asked Prophet Jonah to go to Joppa and deliver the message. But Prophet Jonah thinks that the people of Joppa will not listen to the message. He goes to Nineveh. Now, when he's going to Nineveh by the ship, a storm comes at sea. And it was the superstition at that time that if a storm comes, it's because someone had disobeyed the master. So they normally draw lots. Who's the one who disobeyed the master? So Jonah, being a prophet of God, he volunteers that I'm the one who disobeyed the master. So because he volunteers, they don't have to break his arm or leg or tie his leg. He volunteers, so they throw him overboard. Now, when they throw Jonah overboard, was he dead or alive?
He was alive, according to the Bible.
I'm asking you according to Bible and according to your knowledge. In a storm, when a human being is thrown into a sea, normal human being, when he's thrown into the raging storm in the sea, he ought to die. As far as Jonah is concerned, Jonah was dead or alive? Dead or alive when he was thrown into the sea in the storm? Dead or alive?
He was alive according to the Bible.
Alive according to the Bible. Very good.
Allahumma barik. India on Peace TV.
Allahumma barik ala Muhammad.
A fish comes and gobbles him up. If a fish eats up or gobbles a man, he ought to die. Was Jonah dead or alive?
Alive still, alive according still. To the Bible.
Miracle of a miracle of a miracle. He was thrown, he was alive. In the raging storm, he ought to die, does not die alive. A fish comes and gobbles him up, he ought to die, does not die alive. A miracle of a miracle. 3 days and three nights, the fish takes him around the sea. Out of suffocation, a man ought to die. Was Jonah dead or alive?
Alive, according to the Bible.
According to the Bible. Not according to Dr. Zakir Naik. Miracle of a miracle of a miracle. From the belly of the fish, Prophet Jonah prays to Almighty God. While he was praying, was he dead or alive?
Alive, according to the Bible.
Alive, according to the Bible. A miracle of a miracle of a miracle of a miracle. After 3 days, the fish vomits him out on the shore. Dead or alive?
Alive, according
alive,
to the Bible.
According to the Bible. So according to the Bible, it's a miracle of a miracle of a miracle of a miracle. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, no sign shall be given to you but the sign of Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the fish, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. So if you read the Bible, if you understand the Bible, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was put on the cross on Friday. It was known that the Jews don't crucify on a Sabbath day, on Saturday. So before it becomes sunset, they were in a hurry to get him down. Now, when they get him down, they put him in the sepulcher. In the sepulcher, according to the Bible, was Jesus dead or alive?
He was
alive.
Was
Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, dead or alive?
In where? On the cross or in the tomb?
In the tomb.
In the tomb, they say he resurrected according to the Bible.
Brother, I'm asking you a question. When Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was put in the sepulcher, I'm asking you the question, was Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, according to the Bible, dead or alive?
They say he died on the cross and he resurrected.
I'm asking you in the sepulcher. I'm asking you, what's your name? You said, I stay in Ghana. I'm asking your name. You're saying, I live in Ghana. Brother, do you understand English? I'm asking a simple question in English. In the sepulcher, in the tomb, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was dead or alive? Outside, I'm not bothered. In the tomb, was he dead or alive?
I'm not a Christian. I don't know.
So, brother, what are you?
I don't know, unless you tell me.
If you're not a Christian, what are you?
I'm not religious. I'm still looking for religion.
Oh, you're looking for religion. Okay. So do you believe in the Bible to be the word of God? If you don't believe, then why should I quote the Bible?
I don't believe.
If you don't believe Bible to be the word of God, I'll quote to you Quran, which is the word of God. Even I don't believe Bible is the word of God.
To me also.
If you don't believe Bible is the word of God, even I don't believe Bible is the word of God. There are in the Bible some portions which can be the word of God. There are words of prophets. There are words of historians. There are contradictions. There is pornography. But let me complete my answer. And you're right. According to the Bible, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he was alive. So that's the reason when you're asking me from the Bible that before he was put on the cross, he prays to Almighty God. So God saves him. Because he prays to Almighty God, he does not die on the cross. He's brought down alive. And in the tomb, he's alive. He fulfills the prophecy of the sign of Jonah. That's the reason Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, wasn't crucified. He did not die on the cross. He was saved. And Almighty God raised him up alive. Brother, do you believe? Do you believe there is one God?
I believe.
MashaAllah.
I believe.
Do you believe that Jesus is God?
I don't believe. Because in my African spirituality, I believe in God. But the concept of God that is brought to me is what I don't believe.
Very good. Even I do not believe Jesus is God. Brother, one more question. Third question. Do you believe Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of God?
Yeah, historically, I know Prophet Muhammad existed.
No, do you believe that Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of God?
I know he's a messenger of God.
MashaAllah. So if you believe God is one, and if you believe Muhammad is the messenger of God, that means you're a Muslim.
No, but you see, Muslim preaches about peace. No.
The minimum two criteria.
Dr. Naik.
The minimum two criteria required for any human being to be a Muslim is he has to believe that Almighty God is one and there is no one worthy of worship except Almighty God, which you believe.
Yes,
and
sir.
The second is that Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of that God.
Yeah.
So if you believe in these two things, you become a minimum level of Muslim. You can become more and more practicing later on. For example, if you want admission, if you take admission into a school, suppose the school is St. Peter's School, the school I studied from, you become a St. Peterite. That means you become a student of that school. Now, whether you're in first standard, second standard, third standard, 10th standard, that is later. So if you take admission, you are a student of that school. So for anyone to be a Muslim, minimum two things that he should do is, he should agree God is one, and no one deserves worship except Almighty God. And second is, you should believe that Prophet Muhammad is the messenger. If you believe in these two things, then you become a minimum level of Muslim. Then you can get more knowledge, you can keep on becoming better and better and better. You can go first standard, second standard, third standard, 10th standard, bachelor, master's, PhD, that's later. So according to me, you're a Muslim. Brother, would you like to say it in Arabic?
I'm an African conscious being on earth.
Sorry?
I'm a conscious being on earth.
You're conscious of?
A natural being, a natural human being on earth.
Yes, you are a human being that believes Almighty God is one.
Yeah.
Believe Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of Almighty God.
Yeah.
So according to me, you're a Muslim.
Okay, that's from your view.
Yes, of course, my view only.
Yeah.
And even from your view, because you believe he's God. Muslim means a person who submits his will to God. What is the meaning of Muslim? I told in my talk. Anyone who submits his will to Almighty God and acquires peace by submitting his will to God is a Muslim. So you have submitted your will to God. You believe there is one God, correct?
I believe.
And you believe Prophet Muhammad is a messenger.
Yeah, I believe he
is a messenger. That means you are a minimum Muslim. You can be more practicing by following better things, other things about Almighty God. But the minimum thing that you should follow of Almighty God is believe is one and believe Prophet Muhammad is a messenger. I believe you have just entered the fold of Islam. I'm asking you the question. You said in English.
Yeah.
That there is no one worthy of worship except Almighty God. And you told that Prophet Muhammad is a messenger of God.
Yeah.
I'm asking you, would you like to say it in Arabic?
To say...
Same thing what you said in English. Would you like to say it in Arabic?
I can't speak Arabic.
No, I will help you. Because that is the language of the last and final revelation.
I would like to speak.
You like to say it?
I would like to say it.
Okay. Is anyone forcing you?
No.
You're doing out of your own
it's
free will?
It's something I believe.
If you're doing out of your own free will?
Yeah.
You believe Muhammad is the messenger, peace be upon him, your own free will?
I believe he existed. And he
no one is giving you money?
No.
Okay. I'll say it in Arabic and you repeat it.
Okay.
Ashadu.
Ashadu.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Illallah. Wa ashadu.
Wa ashadu.
Anna. Muhammadan.
Muhammad.
Abduhu. Wa rasuluhu.
For Rasul.
I bear witness. That there is none worthy of worship.
There is none worthy of worship.
Except Allah. And
I bear witness.
That Prophet Muhammad. Is the messenger. And servant of Allah. MashaAllah, you are a Muslim. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you good in this world and the hereafter. I pray to Almighty God. See, once you accept it and become a Muslim, all your previous sins have been forgiven. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant you good in this world and the akhirah. And I want you to read more and more so that you understand this religion better.
Yeah, I read a lot.
And I want you to see more of my DVDs. I'll ask some of the volunteers to give you books. I've got 3 books here in Kumasi. I would ask the volunteer brother Abdul Aziz to give this brother 3 of my booklets. And I would also like to present to you a copy of the Quran. Can some volunteer get me a copy of the Quran here, please? Can some volunteer get me a translation of the Quran, please? Please keep some copies of the translation of the Quran on my table. Yes, brother, can you come and take the translation, please? The brother said that may Allah bless you. And I want to thank you, brother, for saying that. Because once you accept Islam, all your previous sins have been washed away. And I request you to pray for me also. And he said, may Allah bless you. And I'd like to thank you. May Allah guide you more to the truth. And may Allah help you guide your family members and friends to the truth. And even guide this great country, Ghana, to peace, serenity, and to the truth. Allahumma barik ala Muhammad. And we have the second question. Is there any sister, non-Muslim sister, would like to ask a question? Yes, sister.
Please, I'm called Maslin, a student at Sunyan Polytechnic. Please, I would like to know why Muslim ladies always cover their hair. And then the second question is, why they clean their private parts after they shit or after they urinate?
If I heard your question correctly, sister, you said, why do Muslim women cover the head, correct? That's your question.
Yes, please.
And why do they wash their private part after the urinate?
Yes, always.
I will first answer your second question, then come to the first question. As far as washing the private part urination, that's done by Muslim men as well as Muslim women, both. Because we are hygienic. Because when we go for the call of nature, we put water on it so that there are no droplets remaining. I, as a medical doctor, you ask any medical doctor, they will tell you that what the body does not require, it comes out as an excreta or in urine. And these are very harmful for the body. So when you urinate, there are certain drops remaining. When you wash, when you put water, these droplets go away. So it becomes more hygienic and there are less chances of having itchiness and certain diseases in that part. So it is for hygiene and for medical reasons, sister. Regarding your first question, why do Muslim women cover the head? Why do Muslim women cover the hair? The reply is, hijab has been prescribed in the Quran. But before the hijab, for the women, Allah talks about hijab for the men. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 30, say to the believing man that he should lower his gaze and guard his modesty. The moment a man looks at a woman, if any brazen thought, any unashamed thought comes, he should lower his gaze. The next verse speaks about the hijab for the woman. Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 31. Say to the believing woman that she should lower her gaze and guard her modesty, and display not a beauty except what appears off, and draw her veil, a head covering, over her bosom, over her chest, and display not a beauty except in front of her husband, her sons, her fathers, and a big list of mahram, the close relatives who she can't marry is given. There are basically six criteria for hijab. The first is the extent, which differs between the man and the woman. For the man, it's from the navel to the knee. For the woman, the complete body should be covered. The only part that can be seen are the face and hands up to the wrist. Some scholars say that even the face should be covered. But normally, for a woman, a complete body should be covered, including the head and the hair, except the face and hands up to the wrist. The remaining five criteria are the same for the man and the woman. The second is, the clothes they wear, it should not be tight so that it reveals the figure. Third, it should not be transparent or translucent so that you can see through. Fourth, it should not be so glamorous so that it attracts the opposite sex. Fifth, it should not resemble that of the opposite sex. And sixth, it should not resemble that of the unbelievers. The reason why hijab has been prescribed is given in the Quran in Surah Azab, chapter 33, verse number 59, where Allah says, O Prophet, tell your wives and your daughters and the believing women that when they go abroad, they should put on the cloak, the overcoat, so that they shall be recognized and it will prevent them from being molested. So Islam prescribes the woman to cover the head and put on the overcloak so that they shall be recognized and it will prevent them from being molested. I'd like to ask you a question. If there are two twin sisters who are very beautiful, equally beautiful, if they are walking down the streets of Kumasi in Ghana, and one twin sister, she's wearing the Islamic clothes, complete body covered, only part that is seen is the face and the hands up to the wrist. The other twin sister, she's wearing the Western clothes, you know, mini skirt and shorts, wearing a very low, deep neck, revealing more of the body than concealing. And if both these twin sisters are walking down the streets of Kumasi, and if round the corner there is a hooligan, there is a ruffian who's waiting for a catch, who's waiting to tease a girl, I'm asking you the question, sister, will it tease the girl wearing the Islamic hijab or will it tease the girl wearing the Western clothes?
Please, sir, I prefer the lady in the Islamic hijab.
Which girl will it tease? Will he tease the girl wearing the Islamic hijab or tease the girl wearing the Western clothes?
Please, sir, I prefer the lady wearing the Islamic hijab.
He will tease the girl wearing the Islamic hijab. Why?
Yes, please.
Why, but?
It's decent.
I can't hear you.
It's decent.
It is decent.
Yes, please. I didn't get the question well.
No, my question was, if there are two twin sisters who are equally beautiful, very beautiful, walking down the streets of Kumasi, one is wearing the Islamic clothes completely covered, one twin sister, except the face is seen and the hands up to the wrist is seen. The other twin sister, she is wearing the Western clothes, mini skirts and shorts, a top with a deep neck, low neck. Her body is revealed more than concealed. She is exposing more of her body than concealing. And if both the twin sisters are equally beautiful, walking down the streets of Kumasi, and if round the corner there is a hooligan, there is a ruffian who is waiting for a catch, who is waiting to tease a girl, I'm asking the question, which girl will he tease? Will he tease the twin sister who's wearing the Islamic hijab, or will he tease the twin sister who's wearing the Western clothes? Which girl will he tease?
The one in the hijab.
He will tease the girl wearing the hijab. Why, sister? Can you give me one good reason? Can you give me one good reason why will that man tease the girl wearing the Islamic hijab? Only one reason I want.
I will attack the one in the naked dress.
One in the?
Please, they will tease the one in the naked, the short dress.
Ah, correct. It's a simple question, simple answer. He will tease the girl wearing the shorts, the naked dress, because if you invite, then people will come. That's the reason, not only in the Quran, not only in Islam, even in Christianity, it is mentioned. Sister, are you a Christian?
Yes, please.
If you read the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 22, verse number 5, it says, the woman shall not wear clothes that which pertain to a man, and a man will not wear clothes that which pertain to a woman. All those who do, abomination of the law. It's mentioned in the 1st Timothy, chapter number 2, verse number 9. The woman should be dressed up with modesty, with shamefacedness and sobriety. They should not wear broided hair, or gold, or pearl, or costly array. It's mentioned in 1 Corinthians, chapter number 11, verse number 5 and 6, that the woman that prophesieth and prayeth with the head uncovered, her head should be shaved off. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians, chapter number 11, verse number 5 to 6, the woman that prayeth with the head uncovered, her head should be shaved off. Bible is more strict even than the Quran. Nowhere does the Quran say, nowhere does the hadith of Prophet say that if a woman does not cover her head should be shaved off. The Bible is more strict. Have you seen the photograph of Mother Mary? Have you seen the photograph of Mother Mary?
Yes, please.
Is the head covered or not? Covered. Why? For modesty. When you go to church, when you see the nuns cover the head or not? Yes or no?
They do cover their head.
They cover. Why? Because Bible says that. So what Quran says, the same thing is mentioned in the Bible. For modesty, you have to wear the hijab. If you don't wear the hijab, there are chances that you shall be molested. There are chances you shall be raped. In Islam, if any man, after these rules and regulations have been done, rapes a woman, he gets capital punishment, death penalty. Many people say death penalty is a barbaric law, is a ruthless way of life. Do you know in America, the maximum number of rapes that take place in any country in the world, it's in America. According to the 2008 statistics of the National Survey of the Crime Victimization, 203,830 cases of rape took place and 16% were reported. That means every day, 3,590 cases of rape took place. Every 25 seconds, one rape is taking place in America. You know, I'm giving this talk since the past 2 hours. Already more than 200 rapes may have taken place since the time I'm giving a talk here. I'm asking you the question, if you implement the Islamic Sharia in USA, that every man, when he looks at a woman, he should lower his gaze. If any unnecessary